apostles. Then the disciples returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which was near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers. Together the crowd numbered about 120 persons, and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us, and was allotted his share in this ministry. Now this man acquired a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong he burst open in the middle, and all his bowels gushed out. This became known to all the residents of Jerusalem, so that the field was called in their language Hakeldamon, that is, field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, 'Let his homestead become desolate, and let there be no one to live in it. And let another take his position of overseer.' So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection." So they proposed two: Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and the apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. I don't know if you had an opportunity to look in the journals that we have been working on, along with Pastor Eileen, who's working on her journal. But today we are looking at Matthias, who was chosen to replace Judas as a disciple. And the question that Pastor Eileen left for us to ponder and to reflect on is, as we face the future together, who do we want by our side? Whose side do we want to be by? Who is it that we want to walk with, to be with in the journey that God has set in front of us? So as I've been thinking about this, I've termed it in the phrase, who do I want to walk with? Who do I want to walk with me as I continue to be a disciple and a child of God? So I think the easiest way for me to answer that is with a song. And if you know it, please join in. I want Jesus to walk with me. I want Jesus to walk with me. All along my pilgrim journey, Lord, I want Jesus to walk. That's my choice. I want Jesus. I also want someone who can carry a tune that I can copy. But quite honestly, I think that answer is too easy an answer. It's the one that you go to. You know that it's the right answer, right? In children's sermon, what's the right answer all the time? Jesus, that's right. In sermons, what's the right answer all the time? Jesus. So when you're filling out your little devotional guide there, you can write in Jesus, and you'll be right. But you'll also be wrong. find interesting as I look in the Holy Scriptures is that continually in Jesus' ministry, when he was calling his disciples, preparing them for the ministry that he wanted them to do, whenever he sent them two by two. In Mark's gospel, we hear that when Jesus went among the villages teaching, he called the 12 and began to send them out two by two. But they didn't go alone. They were given authority over unclean spirits. They were told, the evangelist Mark tells us, not to take anything with them. You can take a staff, but don't take any bread, don't take any bag, don't take any money. Put your coat on, but rely upon the hospitality of those who receive you, of those who invite you into their home so that they might hear the good news, because they too will be partners with you in this missionary journey. So the disciples went out two by two. But as the ministry continued to develop, especially in the Acts of the Apostles, we find continually, time and time again, that they were going out two by two or even more. The Apostle Paul, after he had his conversion experience, as he traveled through Asia Minor, there was always someone else with him. We even suspect that sometimes Luke was with him. We know that Barnabas was with him, and that at times Thomas, who was one of Paul's disciples, traveled with him as well. I think the worst thing that can happen in the Christian church today is for us to become isolated, whether it's as individuals or as a congregation. Because when we isolate ourselves, we lose one of the blessings that God has chosen to give us of the community and the fellowship of God's people. I hope it wasn't too obvious this morning. You guys were all sitting in here. We were singing with the band. I'm trying to figure out. I'm standing out in the narthex. I couldn't remember what to do next. So I asked Jeff. Did you see when I came off of the riser here at the altar? I looked at Jeff and I said, I've got a children's sermon now, don't I? He said, yes. In addition to any notes that I may have on a sermon and the gospel reading that I use, I also have my bulletin up here. Because the next thing I'm looking for is, okay, after a sermon, let's see, what is it? Oh, turn the page over. It's the hymn of the day. I can't function by myself. And if you want validation of that, just ask my wife or my children. God puts us into community. And while I might think I choose who I walk with, I believe the reality is God makes that choice for me. God places people in my life with whom I can walk, with whom I can be guided, with whom I can share the love that God has given to me. Now, again, as I've been thinking about this, I've been thinking about, oh, okay, who's the people that I have walked with in my life? And all of a sudden, I came out with sort of the top 10, right? Pastor Paul's top 10 people that he walked with. Right? And then I realized that's not the list I need. It's not about colleagues. It's not about bishops or professors. But it's about Art. The man whose home I went to at 11 o'clock on a Sunday night because he and his family were having difficulties. Out of the blue, Art called me. I went. And for the next hour and a half, did I tell you it was on a Sunday night? You know how tired I was? I sat with him and was with his family in their living room, talking and praying and wondering together where God was leading them at that time and at that place in their lives. Art wasn't a member of the congregation. I had fleetingly met him as we were delivering food the prior holiday. That's a person who should be on my list. Or it's also about the times of as I have sat in church studies, and there was a knock on the door, and someone would come in, face a mess, tears evident, saying, "I need someone to talk to." My response always was, "Sit down, I'll shut the door." That's a person I need to have on my list to walk with. Or the times when I've picked up my phone, called my pastor. Did you know that us pastors all have pastors? Yeah? We're asked to designate someone to serve as our pastor. I've picked up the phone, called my pastor, and basically said, "You're in the office, right?" And the answer was, "Yep." I said, "I'm on my way." And I didn't even wait to learn whether the pastor had time for me or not, because I needed someone to talk to. That's the person who needs to be on my list. God gives us the strength and the power to follow in His way. He gives us the brothers and sisters in Christ who are there to support and care for us and for whom God calls us to support and care for. Isn't that what we do with one another? We might be here because we feel we need to be here. But aren't we really here to be present for each other? So the times that I can't sing, I can listen to the voice of someone else who is singing. The times I can't pray, I know that someone else is praying for me. In the times that I see someone who needs a hug or an embrace, I can feel the movement of the Spirit in my life to go to them, to give that hug, that embrace, that warm handshake, that smile, whatever it might happen to be. That's the reason. Praising God, hearing His word, and then putting it into action as you and I walk side by side. Who is it that I need next to me as I walk my Christian journey? For me, the most important thing in the verse in Scripture that I seemingly always come back to is a reminder to me of what I need. It's from the 6th chapter of the prophet Micah, the 8th verse. "He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God." When I walk, that's the image and the goal that I have. That's what I offer to others, and that's what I look for in those with whom I walk. Doing justice, loving kindness, and walking humbly with God. I don't know any other way to answer that question. With God and you at my side, God and me at your side. In Jesus' name.